Thank you for joining us this morning. We're glad many of you signed up for this webinar, and hopefully everyone's safe in the storm. And I'm lucky that I'm not doing this from my little phone because I lost internet connection last night. So that would have been really unfun. So we were waiting a few extra minutes to get people time to acclimate and settle in from that storm that we had. So grab a cup of coffee and let us start the presentation. We are so glad this morning to have two important guest speakers, Juliet Eastland and Susan Labandibar, who have been on the front lines leading campaigns to save our democracy. I'll be introducing them later. Some of you may have heard about the fight in the US Senate to protecting voting rights. I say that with tongue in cheek, I'm hoping many of you have. And the recent votes which failed to change the Senate rules about the filibuster that could have allowed passage of the Freedom to Vote Act. Our speakers today are going to bring us up to date on some of the inside story and how we need to keep up the fight. As we go forward, please put any questions in the chat, and Sherry will be tracking those for the Q&A later in the session. And we also will be keeping people on mute for this webinar. First, I have a brief introduction on what we're fighting. Currently, there are over 400 bills in state legislatures to limit, curtail, or downright prevent people from getting to the polls. The path was set with some of the most draconian measures in Texas and Georgia. One of the more abhorrent and well-known is the one in Georgia, where it is a misdemeanor to give water to people standing in voting lines, punishable by up to a year in jail and a $1,000 fine. I think we can agree that's pretty deplorable, especially since many have had to wait and stand in long lines for hours due to these increasingly restrictive voting laws. Let me share with you two graphics to illustrate some of the ways voting rights are being attacked. Let me preface this by saying that some of these methods are, it's an amalgam of methods or a combination of methods that states are using. They're not all using these methods, but many of them are using many, and this is across many states through state legislatures. Some of these tactics include things from restricting mail-in ballots, to removing drop boxes, to restricting hours, to reducing voting locations altogether, to voting purging, which is in some states, if people don't participate in two elections as a voter, they're purged from the voting rolls and they have to re-register. And the list goes on and on. But one of the more disturbing of all is according to the Brennan Center, Republicans across the country have been passing legislation, effectively giving them more power to actually overturn elections, allowing them to get rid of nonpartisan election officials and simply replace them with their hyperpartisan picks. And they've created a false narrative that our elections are inherently flawed as a pretext to actually make the elections less secure. These are severe attacks on our democracy, and both Congress and concerned citizens all across the country are organizing and fighting back. Today's guest speakers are deeply engaged in voter protection and get out the vote efforts. They will give us more insight into what's at stake and what's happening at the federal and state level. Susan Labandibar is currently co-coordinator at Swing Blue Alliance and was previously the coordinator of Swing Left Greater Boston. And Juliet Eastland is a steering committee member for Sister District and is author of the blog, Why States Matter. Thank you both for joining us. Let's start with Juliet.
Thank you so much, Lisa and Sherry, for pulling together this morning. I'm thrilled to be speaking alongside the amazing Susan Labandibar, and thrilled to be addressing members of this congregation. Thank you for worrying about our democracy and engaging in tikkun olam for our country. As Lisa mentioned, I'm a volunteer and steering committee member for the Mass Rhode Island branch of Sister District Project. We are a national grassroots organization of nearly 60,000 volunteers working in strategic sister districts to build progressive power in state legislatures. And wherever we're supporting a candidate, we're also partnering with a grassroots voter empowerment group on the ground in that state through our State Bridges program. This year, Sister District nationally will be working in probably 10 to 12 states. We don't have our final assignments yet, But I do know we will be in Arizona, Michigan, and Pennsylvania. And if anyone would like to learn more, I'm always happy to speak with any of you anytime. So, voting rights. Martin Luther King Jr. said that while the Civil Rights Act of 1964 gave Black Americans some part of their rightful dignity, without the vote, it was dignity without strength. The power to vote controls all our other rights. And I'd just like to talk about what's happening with voting at the state level and why paying attention to whom we elect as state legislators is so important. Big picture is state laws touch pretty much every aspect of our daily lives, from highway pothole repair all the way up to the biggies, policing, healthcare, environmental laws, gun safety, access to safe and legal abortion, redistricting, which is the redrawing of congressional and state legislative maps that's going on right now across the country, and redistricting's evil cousin, gerrymandering, which is another way the party in power ensures that not every vote counts equally. And of course, state laws govern election procedures. Putting aside the federal arena, which is currently a disaster, gridlocked, our state legislators are the ones making the laws that determine whether voting in our state is easy or hard. So our votes, our lives, literally depend on whom we elect as state legislators. And states are copycats. They keep an eye on other states' legislation and then pilot similar policies at home. We've seen this positively with, for instance, gay marriage, but we're also seeing it in these terrifying ways in real time. As Lisa mentioned, state legislators around the country have introduced over 400 bills in 2021 alone, designed to make voting harder for certain Americans, primarily people of color. Again, our votes and our lives depend on whom we elect to our state houses. Right now, when it comes to voting rights, states have never been more important. At least at this particular moment, Congress is not going to save us. The Supreme Court is not going to save us. States are literally the last bastion of defense against disenfranchisement and dehumanization. We are so lucky to live in Massachusetts, where our state legislators are hashing out the Votes Act, which safeguards a number of voter protections, and I'll talk about that a bit later. Voters in other states are not so lucky. As Lisa mentioned, the putative purpose behind these 400 plus voter suppression measures is to prevent voter fraud, which the Brennan Center for Justice has exhaustively researched and found to be, quote, vanishingly rare. So in fact, these laws are the modern version of the poll tax or the literacy test, and they exist in order to make voting more difficult, particularly for voters of color, although they end up affecting a number of other citizens as well, including poorer voters, rural voters, and voters with disabilities. And as Lisa mentioned, these laws take many forms: removing polling places, cutting hours, making voter list purging easier, capping donations to counties for election administration, tightening voter ID laws, banning drive-through voting, prohibiting drop boxes, and restricting vote by mail. Under this new Texas voting law, for example, a local election official can go to jail for sending out an unsolicited application for a mail-in ballot. I mean, it's fiendish. So once people finally get to the polls, what happens? We all read about those voters waiting 10, 12 hours in line in Georgia. And a New York Times investigation of the 2020 election confirmed the larger truth, which is voters in poorer, less white neighborhoods across the country were much more likely to face longer lines. As they wait in line, these voters are now facing what Latasha Brown, founder of Black Voters Matter, calls a culture of fear. There's that new Georgia law, which criminalizes giving food and water to voters. In Texas, new legislation allows partisan poll watchers free movement around polling places. I don't think general poll watchers there are allowed to be armed yet, but this being Texas, there's got to be a gun somewhere. And sure enough, the official election judge, someone who's appointed by the governor's party and who acts as the sort of presiding power at each polling place, can be armed. Also in Texas, people who assist voters, say voters with disabilities or language barriers, must now sign an oath about their relationship to the voter and about how they plan to help the voter, and they face criminal penalties if they make any kind of error in the paperwork. You've probably heard about Florida, where Governor DeSantis is seeking funding for a new Office of Election Crimes and Security, which is basically a separate police force empowered to, quote, investigate, detect, apprehend, and arrest anyone for an alleged violation of election laws. It's a pretty broad mandate. Ultimately, all these measures are designed to foster an atmosphere of state-sanctioned intimidation at the polls. Finally, there's a number of measures being taken to weaponize the administrative process after the fact, behind vote counting and certification. In other words, to subvert election results after the fact. More evidence, of course, is coming out at the federal level about efforts by the former presidential administration to do just this. But these kinds of shenanigans are also happening at the state level. There are the recounts with, you know, groups like the Arizona Cyber Ninjas. Some states are passing laws transferring more power to Republican-controlled election boards. In Georgia, the Secretary of State, an elected official, has always chaired the state elections board, but no longer. Georgia state legislators can now control the election process more directly because they recently granted themselves the power to select the chair of the elections board. Arizona legislators have passed a law transferring vote counting enforcement from the Democratic Secretary of State to the Republican Attorney General. And across the country, longtime Democratic county election officials are being pushed out. And there's pressure on everyone from the governor all the way down to county level officials to not certify election results. So what can we do now that you're curled up in a little ball of despair? Uncurl and take heart. There is a lot we can do. We have a real opportunity this year, because this November, 88 state legislative chambers in 46 states will be holding midterm elections. 36 states will be holding elections for between 2 and 5 top level statewide offices, US Senator, Governor, Lieutenant Governor, Attorney General, and Secretary of State. So one thing we can all do is support ethical candidates from Governor to Secretary of State to state senators and reps, all the way down to county election officials. You might even consider running for a local office. And keep in mind, we regular people with our small dollars and our little amounts of time can have a big impact at the state level. Congressional races are big and sexy and they run into the gazillions of dollars. State races are often run on a shoestring. Sometimes the campaign office is literally an intern and a computer. Our team did a lot of work in Virginia, where the salary for a state house delegate is just under $18,000 a year. So every dollar you give, every phone call you make, and every postcard you write has a huge impact at this level. Of course, trying to figure out which candidates and races to support in which states can be crazy making, unless you're a real political junkie. That intensive research can really be overwhelming. It certainly is for me. And that's why I volunteer with a group that has done the research, vetted the candidates, and selected specific races to support. There are many fantastic groups out there, Sister District, Swing Blue Alliance, many others, which will help do the research and narrow the field. Another area of big impact, follow the Stacey Abrams model and support grassroots voter empowerment organizations. These groups don't just show up on election day. They're there on the ground day in and day out, 365 days a year, figuring out ways to reach underserved populations and get people registered. Last year, our team supported the New Virginia Majority, the New Georgia Project Action Fund, and Pennsylvania Stands Up. And we heard directly from their leaders about the incredible work their volunteers are doing, knocking on doors and registering new voters. Again, there are lots of great partner groups out there you can join and great groups on the ground you can support directly. Finally, a word about our home state. Last October, the Mass State Senate approved the Votes Act, and 3 days ago, the Mass House approved its version, which would make pandemic-era emergency reforms permanent, including vote by mail for all future elections, an expanded window for early in-person voting, and jail-based voting reforms. This is fabulous. However, unlike the Senate bill, the House version does not allow same-day voter registration. Instead, it authorizes an open-ended study of the money and labor same-day registration would entail. So the House and Senate are set to begin final negotiations. If you feel strongly about enshrining same-day voter registration in state law, call your state rep and let them know. Believe it or not, state officials really do listen to their constituents. They really do take note of how many calls and letters and emails they get. I was once on Beacon Hill lobbying for gun safety laws, and the state rep I talked to said that both NRA and anti-abortion bills come up in the Massachusetts state legislature every session, but it's concerned citizens who are paying attention and contacting him who make the difference to put the pressure on our legislators. So raise your voice. I'll end with some words from Martin Luther King Jr. when he spoke at the conclusion of the 1965 Voting Rights Act march from Selma to Montgomery, Alabama. He said, "Let us march on ballot boxes until race baiters disappear from the political arena. Let us march on ballot boxes until the Wallaces of our nation tremble away in silence. Let us march on ballot boxes until all over Alabama, God's children will be able to walk the earth in decency and honor. We extend that wish to the country as a whole, and may we, as children of whatever God we worship, work for decency and honor wherever we are." Thank you so much.
Thank you so much. We really appreciate that, Juliet. That was phenomenal. What a array of tactics we're dealing with, and what a fight we have, but very hopeful, very, very hopeful. So now we'd like Susan Labandibar to please present. She is very, very qualified and very knowledgeable about this topic, and will speak on the federal level. Susan, take it away.
Juliet, I recently heard Karen Hobart Flynn, the president of Common Cause, speak upon the failure of the Freedom to Vote Act. And I swear, you did just as good a job as she did. You were amazing. Thank you so much. That was just, I mean, it was terrifying, but it was a great introduction to what we're up against. First let me just explain who I am, because it's a little confusing sometimes. I'm somebody who was actually a climate activist before Trump was elected. And after he was elected, I decided that what I was going to focus on was helping people in blue states take action to make sure that the federal government was aligned with their values. And I recognize that all of us have so many skills to contribute, but sometimes it's very difficult to know how to best contribute. I'm sure almost everyone here has been on a phone bank and gotten hung up on, or written a postcard and wondered whether it made a difference, or knocked a door and had someone say, "Oh, it's that political lady. It's somebody here about politics." And so it's frustrating, because we see how serious this is, and we don't really know sometimes what to do. Not to mention the fact that most of us have a college degree, advanced degrees, all kinds of skills to contribute. And even when we are volunteering, we may be doing something that may not directly relate to what we have to contribute. So I've worked very hard in different ways to try to help you make a difference. And some of the ways that, starting back to Force Multiplier, where Sherry and I first met, and then I was the regional organizing coordinator for Swing Left National, working in the New England region, and at the same time started a group called Swing Left Greater Boston, which recently, last summer, renamed itself to be called Swing Blue Alliance. And we remain a swing left group, but we're also affiliated with Indivisible, which has been a terrific move for us and very helpful when it came to voting rights advocacy. We found that working with Indivisibles across the state was a tremendous opportunity to make our voices heard. And I'm going to flip on a few slides that I prepared for you this morning to talk about how we worked in Massachusetts to lift up the cause of voting rights. Actually, before I do, I wanted to say that one of the things that we learned while we were doing this voting rights advocacy is that surprisingly, it's not on most people's radar screens. And so what that means to me is that every time we lift up the importance of the right to vote, we're making a difference, because until this issue gets the kind of attention that it needs, we're not going to be able to make the changes that we need. So I'm going to share my screen for a sec. Okay, can people see that?
Okay. Yeah, we're good.
Oh, okay. I like this quote. Let's assume victory and go out and make it happen. So 2020, I'll skip this, but and I know a lot of us volunteered, and that was terrific. And we got some of what we wanted. This is us, Massachusetts' largest grassroots organization of its kind. We're completely volunteer. We're no organizational status. We're not a PAC. We're just people. This is, before I get into the voting rights thing, I just wanted to mention that as part of my quest to make sure that people's actions are as effective as they can be, we've come up with this acronym called Aim High, and basically that what we're doing needs to be additive and complement other actions, that it needs to be important according to our strategy of what's important. It needs to be measurable. It needs to be helpful. As Juliet mentioned, Sister District is working with groups on the ground. That's so important, and that's what we do as well. And finally, impactful. We have our own research department, which is not as good as Sister District's research department. I think Sister District has the best research department around, but it's nonetheless unique in that I don't believe there are any other grassroots groups that have their own research department. There is an upcoming event that is so popular, I'm actually embarrassed. As of today, we have 350 people registered for it. And it is to reveal the results of our 2020 mailing program. And we're going to be talking about Aim High and how what questions you should ask before you undertake a postcard program. It's on Wednesday at 7 p.m. And I wanted to just do a quick dive into what we did. In a way, it was really to prevent the end of the second Reconstruction, in the sense of that these acts, had they been passed, would have been a huge help in preventing this new wave of voter suppression laws. And we sent 500,000 postcards to voters in key states. And those postcards generated over 5,000 calls to key senators. At Common Cause as a whole, we were working with Common Cause, and Common Cause as a whole made 5 million phone calls. And many of these were from Massachusetts. Not only did Swing Blue Alliance, and we still have weekly phone banks, but there are other Indivisibles across Massachusetts that are still making phone calls. Shout out to Indivisible Northampton, that has been an inspirational leader in these phone banks. And finally, I want to show you some pictures from the wonderful statewide rallies we organized with Indivisible Massachusetts Coalition. This is one of my favorite pictures. We organized 5 rallies. Indivisible Mass Coalition organized 6. We didn't participate in one of them because we were actually just burned out. but these are some of the rallies that we organized. Each one of them had multiple locations. Many of them had 18, 20 locations, 25 locations, some of them. And some of them we involved trips down to DC, like the August 28th March on Washington for voting rights. And here's another weekend of action on October 23rd. This was a campaign that we designed with Indivisible Massachusetts Coalition. We had a giant letter to Biden, and we had the filibuster ban van that went around to different rallies and gave people the opportunity to sign the giant Biden letter. This was one of them on the Keep. There are the letters. We finally brought them to DC and participated in a huge civil disobedience and had the privilege of getting arrested with Reverend Barber. This is my friend, Jamie French, waiting to get her to pay her fine. We didn't actually go to jail, thank goodness, but we did get arrested. And this is in DC. And then finally, on the 1 year anniversary of the insurrection, we had vigils across the state of Massachusetts. And here are some of the pictures from the vigils. I actually have hundreds and hundreds of pictures. This is in Concord. And there were many faith communities that had vigils. And as I said, we're still having phone banks today. So that is some of the voting rights work that we've done. And, you know, my takeaway from this is that this is not a political calculus. Having the opportunity to advocate for voting rights with faith leaders made me realize that this is just the continuation of what we've been doing since the beginning of our democracy. And it's our turn now to continue to advocate for voting rights. So I hope that all of you will make that a part of your advocacy. Let's take a quick trip over the border to New Hampshire. So in New Hampshire, we helped the New Hampshire Democrats advocate for the election of Senator Maggie Hassan, and she won by just 1,000 votes. She's up for re-election in 2022. In addition, in 2018, there was an open seat in the first congressional district, and Chris Pappas won that seat. Chris Pappas is a phenomenally popular congressman, which is why the New Hampshire state legislature, which is now completely Republican controlled, is drawing maps to try to gerrymander him out of his seat. Some of the maps that they're drawing involve moving 25% of the voters of New Hampshire from one district to another, which is completely unheard of in the 114 years of redistricting in New Hampshire. Unfortunately, on November 3rd, 2020, Republicans flipped both houses of what they call the General Court, which is the state legislature, and they also took the executive council, and their governor is a very popular Republican, Chris Sununu. So they have a trifecta now, and they're advancing a radical agenda that involves voter suppression tactics, an abortion ban, and a very anti-public school agenda, among many other things. Swing Blue Alliance has a full-featured program of voter contact activities. We're working with the Pappas campaign and with the New Hampshire Democratic Party and with a group called 603 Forward to do a variety of things, including canvassing, deep canvassing. We have a deep canvassing training coming up this week, postcard campaigns, volunteer recruiting, and phone banks. So that's New Hampshire. And finally, I wanted to let you know about a program called Volunteers Taking Back Democracy. This program recruits volunteers in the swing states where they're most needed. We work with partners on the ground and call people who are either people who vote a lot, you know, or high partisan Democrats who vote a lot, or people who have volunteered in the past. And we use principles of motivational interviewing, which is basically a technique that was pioneered for use actually with people struggling with substance abuse disorders, to talk to people and find out how they're feeling about the upcoming elections and see if they might be interested in volunteering. And we do that on a weekly basis. And right now we're calling in York County, Pennsylvania, and talking to people on the ground about whether they want to get involved. And it's wonderful because it feels like you're being transported into another place where things are very, very different. And when you have these conversations with people and listening to what they're struggling with, I find it to be just wonderful and very enlightening. So we're working with the PA Dems and turn PA blue. It's part of our larger strategy of helping to rebuild the Democratic Party at the grassroots level. And that's it. I think I'll probably stop there. So thank you.
Great. Thank you so much, Susan and Juliet, providing so much information and such a broad picture of what's going on. Of course, it's discouraging for many of us when we hear about all this, but we want to still motivate people and help people to think about how they might become involved. So I haven't seen too many questions, if any, except one about mass votes in the chat, but I'm gonna start off with a couple of them and hopefully people will add in. So to both of you, you spoke about it a little bit, but if you can just say more about, you know, how you think it's best for people to be able to keep up their activism, their sense of hope, and a feeling that what they're doing is making a difference. Juliet, you want to go first, and then if Susan wants to.
Sure. This is, of course, something I struggle with. And I have found, for me, two things have helped. One is finding a group with a lens that resonates for me. Like, I'm somebody who I just can't get too involved too deeply in each issue. You know, abortion or gun safety, because I go crazy. So having learned that about myself, you know, I found a group that is one step removed from that. We work to elect people who will grapple with these issues. So I have found I have the privilege of and the luxury of finding a distance for myself, you know, that doesn't deplete me so much. And the other thing I think about is just, you know, I think about what it must be like to be Black in this country at any point in this country's history, and how long things take. And really, anything that is worth fighting for, it doesn't happen quickly. And we are still on the path, and we've made progress, and there's more to go. So that kind of very, very long view helps me. So.
Thank you, Juliet. Susan?
Well,
it's your job. That's your work to get us to feel motivated and inspired.
Yeah. And I think it's funny because people say to me, oh my God, nobody wants to volunteer. Everybody's depressed and discouraged. And honestly, I haven't quite experienced that. When I talk to people, especially one-on-one, and let them know that and give them hope that there's a community of people that they can connect to. Like you take, and I hate to put you, at least I don't know you, but I do know Sherry. And I want to lift up Sherry for a moment, because connecting to Sherry for me is one of the things that I think that you can do, because Sherry has been in this fight for quite a long time. She's a servant leader. And Lisa, I know that you probably are too, but this is how we actually get stronger together, is that we get together in groups where people know each other, like each other, respect each other. And it's that ability to be with people who are feeling the same urgency as you are and who want to take action and not be out there with people who are like, you know, maybe they're concerned, but they're not doing anything. They're just they're just complaining about it. And that gets really wearing. So if you're with people who are taking action and you're focused on what we can do rather than all the bad things that are happening and feeling a lack of agency, you'll feel better. You know, you really will feel better. Sometimes I worry about people if they're not taking action. And because I can see sometimes that they're getting depressed. And actually the antidote to that is actually getting back together with people that you respect and care about and taking action together with them. So that's my suggestion, is to make this group really work and to do things together. And I can almost guarantee you that you'll feel better.
Can I just add one? Can I add one thing to that? Yeah. That absolute, like, amen. That is such a good point. Such a good point that personally it helps you. But I would also, I just wanted to say that I often think about the women behind the bus boycott in the South, which were, you know, one woman would call five of her friends. And that's how the word spread about the boycott. And that's the kind of little actions behind the scenes that led to something really, really big. So even a little action that you do, something that feels little, you know, can really be part of a much greater whole.
Well, Juliet, I think that there were some people who did call people today and ask them to come to this meeting. So I think that's happening.
That's great. Thank you to you both. I'll just add in one line that I heard long ago. It was actually related to Israel-Palestine. If we think of intractable problems and challenges, that's one a lot of us can connect to. And hearing an Israeli peace activist saying, we don't have a choice. We don't have a choice to give up. You know, we can't get discouraged and say, oh, it's too hard. And I think that's for us as well. We don't really have a choice. There are a couple of questions that have come up, and let me ask one of them. Actually, I'm going to add on to this. Susan, at the federal level, since is there anything that you have insight into or can say that you think is going to be happening in the Senate, even if it doesn't involve volunteers, but any perspective on that? And then someone has asked about, you know, what you think about court challenges, you know, the prospect for court challenges to some of the state laws. And that might go to Juliet as well.
Well, I mean, obviously, I think people are thinking about the Electoral Count Act and what we can, you know, how that can be used as a vehicle. I mean, Common Cause is still trying to soften the ground. Whatever passes is going to have to be bipartisan, which is why they're calling Marco Rubio and Lisa Murkowski and Susan Collins. I forgot if it's Susan Collins, but those are so that is a signal that you know, we're trying to. I mean, and getting the Electoral Count Act passed is nothing. It will help save. You know, I say, you know, shore up some aspects of how we elect our president in 2024, which is obviously a concern. And then at the state level, this is only my own personal issue, which is that we work a lot with mail-in ballots or vote by mail. And one of the most contentious areas right now in terms of litigation is how and when people will be able to vote by mail.
Once again, I mainly have the perspective of you know, how do we take effective action? So
the problem is that voters are going to be in a constant state of confusion around, and also it's a chill effect. There are decisions that have to be made. So for example, just on Friday in Pennsylvania, the Commonwealth Court tried to disallow no excuse mail-in ballots. However, because the Supreme Court, we think that basically currently the thought is we're gonna proceed as though that's not gonna stick. But on the other hand, in Georgia, where we were going to try to do an end run around SB 202, which is
the, you know, kind of comprehensive omnibus voter suppression bill par excellence, legislation par excellence. We talked to the director of the state director of voter protection, and she said, look, there at this point, vote by mail is no longer a reliable way to help increase turnout because of the whole gauntlet of barriers that SB 202 puts in the way of mail ballots. So we're switching to early voting. So that was like a whole arrow that got taken out of our quiver in Georgia. Now we talked to the Voter Participation Center, which sent, and we sent 560,000 voter application, vote by mail applications in Georgia for the runoffs. They sent millions. They are currently planning, they're litigating, you know, they're hoping that some of these laws will be overturned, but it's all a political calculus, right? We don't know. And in the meantime, you know, kind of you lose time, right? You just, it's all this stuff creates a lot of confusion. It puts a chill on our strategy. And then also then we have this other task of trying to educate voters of how they can vote. And the problem with that is that if you send something to a voter that says, okay, it's hard to vote this year, here are all the things you need to do, you know, your people who are less likely to vote are like, well, okay, it's hard to vote, let's not do that, you know. So it's a challenge.
Okay. We have two related questions. One is, what's the strongest thing that you feel you can say to people who say when they hear phone banking, they think, not for me, I can't do that. I can't cold call people. You know, I don't want to do that. We do have people who do it and know it can be frustrating. You can take a while to get to speak to people and wrong numbers and occasionally somebody who's challenging. But what's your strongest thing that you can say about to try to encourage people to try that out? And also if you could say a little bit more, Susan, about the deep listening idea, the deep, which you've talked about and I've participated in.
Well, why don't you let Juliet go for okay. first, and then I'll talk about, and Juliet, maybe you might want to talk about, you know, people say phone banks, but in fact, it's, you know, when you're in the phone bank world, you realize it's like the Eskimo word for snow. I mean, there's so many different kinds of phone banks, you know.
Yeah. I personally am somebody who dreads phone banking. and so I often tell people that, you know, it scares me. I'm afraid I won't know enough, blah, blah, blah. And it's really not that scary. It's just another person on the end of the line. And even every wrong number you get and every hang up you get is such an important data point for the campaign. That is one less question mark for them. So it's critical. You know, even you are taking on that frontline frustration and hang ups and this and that, you're taking that on for the campaign. And that is a really important data point. So nothing about phone banking is for naught. You can really, it's every call really does matter. And it's just, I don't know, it's just people. You know, I think people, what was the statistic in the country? People would rather people fear public speaking more than they fear death or something, you know. It's just speaking to another person. It really is manageable. So,
yeah. Okay.
Speaking as someone who's done it, you know, I can testify. It can be a little frustrating. You expect a very low, you know, return, but that low return can matter because certain elections are won by 1,000 votes. And also, there's still the postcard writing and the text banking, right? So that's still something that is a viable strategy that is being employed by all these groups.
All right. Well, thanks. But I think I want to take a much more positive view of phone banking.
Yes, please do it. I've been doing a lot of it. So I think I have the the rights to state it, but please. Susan.
Well, I know, but it sounded like cod liver oil, you know, so.
Thank you, Susan.
All right, well, first of all, we have to recognize that we're here. This is a pandemic. And the fact is that people are very isolated. And phone banking is one of the few ways that you can talk to somebody without giving them a virus. I mean, I think phone banking is changing as a result of the pandemic. And some of the conversations that you have with people are even more meaningful. I mean, part of it is it really depends on the script. I do want to say that I would like to disagree. There are phone banks that are not worth doing. I'm very sorry to say. and in fact, you should vet the script. If you don't feel comfortable with the phone bank, I'm really going off script here. But in fact, if you don't like the phone bank, don't do it. There are many different kinds of phone banks. The other thing is that we need to consider who we are. We are people calling from Massachusetts into another state. There are certain times when that, there are certain functions that we can serve that are good and that are really valuable. And sometimes it's not. So one of the things, I think one of the most impactful things that you can do right now, and this is, this does sound like I'm promoting my own thing, but it's because this is, we started these things because of me thinking so deeply about what would really be the highest use for people in Massachusetts who wanted to make phone calls, and that's to recruit volunteers on the ground. So you're not calling people and asking them to vote. You're calling and asking them if they want to volunteer. And it's a very different conversation. And you're asking them to do something much harder. You're asking them to give up hours and hours and hours, and you're asking them to come out as a Democrat in a place where that is not necessarily even safe. So that's where the deep listening comes in. This is not a sales job. This is opening the door to a conversation and listening to them and finding the crack in the door, the part where they start, as you start listening to them and they start to talk about what's important to them, then that becomes the opportunity to start talking about the opportunities that there are there in their local community for them to get involved.
Thanks. Thank you. Clarifying.
I want to add something to that. I was doing phone calling to try to get the Freedom to Vote Act passed, and I was calling into voters in Arizona and West Virginia. That was the focus on Kyrsten Sinema and Manchin. And it was interesting because using some of these techniques where you just try to engage somebody, you know, this is why I'm calling, but is that something that's important to you? Or is there some other issue more important to you? And even people, I was interested, it was those states, but people who in the end would say, well, I don't support this. I mean, they all wanted voter ID. But even those people who did pick up, I was in conversation with some of those people for a while. You know, we kind of took it back and forth a bit. And even though they said in the end, well, I won't do this, or I won't, you know, make the call to encourage them, you know, to vote for it. So that was an interesting experience for me. And I would say most of the phone bank, coordinators will always say, when you say, oh, I only got one person, you know, to say yes, and they'll say, look, but we got all together in our group, 50 people. And so you're one person, you know, is a drop that goes into 50. And in fact, there were 10 phone banks that night. So really there were 500, and that's really great. So there is that multiplier, you know.
Well, Sherry, not only that, the problem is people, you don't have a large enough sample size. When you do a phone, when you participate in a phone bank, you may get nobody. But together, you know, but somebody else might get 10 people. So it's not, you have to think of yourselves, as you said, collectively, is that collectively the phone bank generated this many calls. So that's, you're right. And if you weren't there, then somebody else would have had those not homes, you know.
Mm-hmm. And I've had some great conversations over, you know, 3 years of doing this. So many fun engagements. It's been such an eye opener, honestly.
Yeah.
Okay, I see that Juliet's been able to respond to one or two people in the chat. Susan also put in the active listening, the link for signing up for that. And Claudia had asked about, are there groups particularly working with Black churches, working on the ground with Black churches? And I would just make one reference, and I want to say, so we have this resource list. Somebody already had some trouble. It's as a Google Drive document. We can send it out to people as a Word document attachment afterwards. And if you're particularly interested, if you can email me about that, because I'm not sure I'll get all the people who came in, you know, who didn't pre-register. But I do want to mention one group. Definitely that a lot of people know about, Movement Voter Project. And that's a group, and it's in our resource list, that they don't enlist volunteers to do the phone calling, whatever, but they raise money to channel into grassroots groups. And I know it's like 600 in all these critical states. And they're groups on the ground that do voter outreach and voter engagement and voter registration and work on candidate campaigns, along with many of them, other kind of, you know, social justice issues. So they're working in communities around, you know, affordable housing or, you know, an environmental issue or something like that. And they also do the electoral work. And that's when, what else can I do? Donating money is another thing people, you know, can do, and we can help get people to learn more about that. Force Multiplier that Susan mentioned is a group that does target certain federal candidates in key states, and their function is to organize Zooms for people to be able to hear candidates speaking, and then they're also a fundraising mechanism. So then they're looking for donations that can go into the campaigns. Again, as a temple, we can't do that in a coordinated way, but people can do that individually, and they're on the list. That question, and I think that many of those groups are probably working with faith congregations on the ground. That's sort of an assumption. I will let Susan respond to that. Just to mention that through JALSA, you know, locally, that the Jewish Alliance for Law and Social Action, some of you participated in a postcard campaign that was in Florida, and it was the group Faith in Florida that is a kind of church-based kind of advocacy group. Those were postcards to reach out to recently registered voters, trying to keep communication with them. And it was encouraging them to participate in a local election. Not that that was as significant, but to get people in the practice, you know, of voting. And we were able to, as a congregation, you know, participate in that. So Susan, do you have anything else to say about any particular groups or efforts working with Black churches?
I just wanted to, I did want to mention that Force Multiplier also has, you know, a C3, you know, fund. I mean, you can also donate to groups on the ground through Force Multiplier as well.
Mm-hmm. Right.
Yeah. I think part of it is like so many of the Black voter empowerment groups, I mean, faith is just a critical part of what they do. You know, whether it's you know, Reverend Barber's group or Black Voters Matter. There's so many different groups that and they work through the. I mean, Black Voters Matter, I think, is a great group, and you can. I would strongly suggest, you know, giving them a small donation. So.
Mm-hmm. Black Voters Matter. Okay, great. Can you just tell us, Susan, you've done the pitch for the Groundhog, the session on postcarding. Can you give a little, it's like a preview, like, yes, there is evidence that it makes some difference, and only in, you know, in certain kind of campaigns, or will people walk away with, gee, I thought I could get away with just writing postcards, but I really ought to put my time into some phone banking.
Well, you know, the wonderful thing about joining this Groundhog Day thing is that everyone who joins is almost like kind of creating a mandate for people who create postcard campaigns across the country to say, hey, you know what? The people who write these postcards actually do want their work to be evidence-based. So so even just by joining, you know, we can because we have been going to postcard people who have postcard programs around the country and saying, do you know what? This is great that there are millions and millions of people sending millions and millions. I mean, hundreds of millions. I'm talking, if you look at how many postcards were sent in 2020, it was by volunteers. It was well over 100 million postcards. I mean, we practically saved the post office. Together, we are creating a mandate for the day when every postcard activity provider sees it as a part of their mandate to study like Sister District. I mean, Sister District is just so ahead of the game. And they all of them should be like Sister District. And then once we get everybody to do a study, then we'll get everybody to do a good study, because then some of the studies that are out there are not very good. So that's the next thing. But essentially, yes, you're going to find out. So what are some of the best practices that you could look for? And everybody will get a handout with questions that they should ask.
I would just say that, yeah, most of a lot of, you know, political groups do their own research and then keep it under lock and key. And so Sister District, for example, is committed to doing constant research. I mean, really, I feel like a guinea pig sometimes. And making the results available to everybody. So I put a link in the chat.
Well, I'm not sure that we have, we're over. We're 4 minutes over, Lisa said. So this has been fabulous. Thank you so much to Susan and Juliet, both for your work and your incredible work and leadership and creative thinking in this field, and joining us this morning within this at this time to share your wisdom and encouragement with all of us. And for those who are participating, just a couple of things. One is that Lisa and I are the kind of point people in our Tikkun Olam committee at the temple in trying to bring opportunities to people in the congregation for, you know, ways to become involved as a congregation, and then to help share resources that people can pursue, you know, on their own. And we did have a good, we've had about 20 people, who, I would say 20 to 25, who've done postcarding in the past from 2020 and on one campaign or another. And also I know that after we did a Zoom a year ago, in advance of 2020 about phone banking and texting, that there were members who did get themselves signed up. I look at Nita and Franz around, who I know did that, and, you know, and found that they could do it. So anyway, if you have follow-up questions, you know, you can always be in touch with us. I think everybody knows our emails. And we will, for the resource document, Lisa, maybe you can put the link in one more time. You know, anyone who was on the Zoom, if you registered, we've got your email address. We'll try to remember who else is here.
I'll be able to share the chat, so don't worry about that. I'm going to get our email addresses in there right now for everybody. For Sherry, that's Sherry's. And for me, I'll get that in a second.
If anybody didn't sign up, and they definitely want to be on a list, if you want to put your email address in the chat.
Chat should be saved in the recording. So when we get the recording, we'll also be able to find a place to hold it and be able to send to the group. So I'll be in charge of that.
So thank you, everybody, so much. Bye-bye.
Susan and Julia, thank you again for your time and your expertise. We so appreciate your speaking to us today. It was really invaluable.
Oh, it was a pleasure. Thank you very much.
And we look forward to working with you. Thanks to everybody.
Bye-bye.
Thank you so much. And build your muscles shoveling out that snow.